What is going on, everybody? It's your boy, the Slab Train. Welcome back, guys, to another video today. Now, today we actually have something different, and this is something that I've been actually really looking forward to today. Now, we are joined with Dave Singh right now. Welcome to the channel, my man. How are you doing today?
Hey, man, doing great. Thanks for having me here.
Now, Dave, you are the creator of StreetLegalRacing.com. Is that correct?
StreetLegalMods.com.
StreetLegalMods, I do apologize. So StreetLegalMods.com, and we are going to be discussing today a brand new game that you guys are in pretty much making right now, Street Tuning Evolution, made by Invictus Games. So I'm very, very excited to have you on the channel today, you know, discussing all these things. We have a lot of questions from a lot of subscribers that hopefully we can clear up today and really, you know, bring light to this absolutely amazing next-gen game that should be hitting sometime 2015 or 2016 are we looking at?
Yeah, we're looking at an alpha release, quarter four, 2015.
That's incredible. So, some of the big things, I mean, did you want to just maybe discuss yourself, you know, maybe just give a little insight on the company, you know, where you're from?
Absolutely. The StreetLegalMods.com is just a fan site for Street Legal Racing, which is a game that Invictus Games made way back, I think, 2003. And it's just a great game with hands-on tuning and customization that we don't see in a lot of games today. So as far as my role in this, that's a website that I manage. It's fairly popular. And we're involved in this new game right now with Invictus. And it's a little bit different than the last game that they've been involved with. There's going to be no publisher. We will be crowdfunding the game. And a lot of how the game will be built and the features in the game will be community-driven, meaning that the community is going to have a great say in how the game is going to turn out.
Which is huge, I think, because, I mean, nowadays the community runs and drives a lot of games, and that, I mean, is the key, I feel at least. I mean, I was a huge fan of, you know, the first two. I didn't get as much time that I would like to in those games, but I feel, though, that this is really going to be, you know, a huge, huge bang, especially for, you know, with all the games that are coming out that are lacking, you know, the customization, you know, lacking all these things that we want in a game. And, I mean, especially for, you know, the community to really decide, you know, what the final product is, or, you know, what the final product will be after all the mods is, you know, it's just, I have no words for it, man. It's crazy.
Great. Yeah.
It's crazy.
Something that we've been looking for a long time now is to see another game like Street Legal, whether it was made by Invictus or not, you know, as we just haven't found anything like it. So what makes this game special is the fact that you can take apart the car by hand, you know, hands-on, and repair it and fix it, upgrade it, tune it, take it out, drive it, and crash it. So it's really a very unique game in that respect. So we're really happy that we're having the potential here to do something like that again.
The gameplay that we're watching right now has some very, very in-depth stuff, you know, stuff that we've never seen from an SLR game before. You know, the customization, the in-depth detail, I mean, I'm in shock, to be honest with you, with, you know, what I'm looking at, and I am very excited to see, you know, what's to come. I mean, the game is not even close to being finished, if I'm not mistaken. I mean,
absolutely, it's less than 1%, if you could imagine that. You know,
wow.
this is just a couple of weeks of work on from Invictus right now, putting this project together in some very tight deadlines they have going on back at their headquarters there. So putting this together, definitely a big shout out to them, and congrats for getting this much work done in a little bit amount of time. But yeah, keep in mind that what we're looking at right now is just some really super basic stuff right now. There's a lot of details that we could probably spot out right now that are wrong with it, but you know, it's just a work in progress, but it looks good so far.
Fair enough. Now, I mean, before we get into the details of, you know, the crowdfunding and all that stuff, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the gameplay on this game. Now, I mean, obviously we don't have a lot of it yet. Do you have any ideas of, you know, game modes? Are we going to be seeing, you know, different things from that? Is there going to be anything that sets it apart from the previous Street Legal Racings that we've seen?
Absolutely. Well, when we talk about this new project here, what we're doing is Street Tuning Evolution, and one of the first things that we did when coming together with the features of this game is that we were asking our own Street Legal community what they would like to see in a new Street Legal racing game. So it was very obvious that the top priorities were pretty much the same among everybody, and we wanted to make sure that we brought those to this new game, and we didn't really bring too much to the game where it would change it completely and not be anything like Street Legal. So we wanted to make sure that we kind of kept those core elements and fundamentals that we saw from the original series and brought them to this new current gen game. So as far as what it will have that Street Legal doesn't, I can't really talk about those in detail right now because it's a little bit too early for that.
Fair enough.
I can tell you that what you do love about Street Legal, you will find in this game, and it won't be we won't be bringing the things that were bad about Street Legal, like the bugs and all that kind of stuff. So we're going to be improving a lot, but bringing the good points.
So I guess pretty much come back later for more info on, you know, gameplay, stuff like that, because that is definitely, I feel a lot of people are, you know, nail biting. They want to know what's going down.
I can tell you that, you know, the basics are definitely going to be there. So if people who don't know Street Legal, I can tell you that you're going to, you know, you'll be able to have a car, you'll, you know, be able to upgrade it and tune it and repair it as you need. And you're going to take this car out in the street and you can race it for money. And depending on how far we can get with the development here with the crowdfunding and stuff, we would really like to kick that up a few more notches from what it used to be and have organized racing and events throughout the city map. We want to integrate racing tracks within the city map as well. So we really want to expand on one big city map for this game, and I think that will definitely make the gameplay pretty cool. You know, potentially bring back some things that we've seen in the first Street Legal, like parts stores where you could drive to a store and buy some parts for your car.
Yes,
and a little bit cheaper than ordering them from the catalog in the garage. So there's going to be a lot of cool little things. You know, I'm kind of running in circles with it, but there's a lot to it. But it will be really, really interesting.
No, I mean, this is a huge game to even, you know, try to get one thing is very tough to just kind of pinpoint. So I definitely hear you on that. Now, I don't know if you can confirm or deny this. Is it going to be an open world style game like the previous ones?
Absolutely, yeah. The aim for this is definitely to make it as, you know, as open as possible. So do whatever you want as you want. You know, if you want to, if you're just interested in cruising around online with your friends, showing off your cars, that's fine. You know, if you guys want to, you know, go out for racing, you like drag racing, you want to go drifting, whatever kind of style of racing you like, you know, you can do it. So there won't be kind of like some kind of set path that you have to follow. So
okay.
I think that's really important.
That's awesome. Now, going a little bit away from the gameplay style, I wanted to talk a little bit about the Kickstarter, about the crowdfunding, stuff like that. So how come you decided to do the crowdfunding instead of, you know, going to an actual publisher and trying to get the game published like that?
Yeah, that's a really good question. That's something that I think we need to answer for everybody. It's important to realize that when we look at the past projects from Invictus and everything like that, we talk about some of the downfalls with those projects like Street Legal and things like that. A lot of people talk about, you know, the game was buggy and, you know, this and that was lacking. So we have to understand the circumstances that a project like that has to come under to experience those kind of flaws. And when we look at, you know, dealing with a publisher, it's, you know, there's nothing wrong with those companies. I mean, I don't mean to talk down on them or anything, but they do set some deadlines that sometimes are unrealistic for developers to meet.
Okay.
And in these days, I really believe that games are more about, you know, the commercial aspect versus, you know, when we look at the passion that goes behind them from the developers. So we want to make sure that developers putting in this game, we're going to see 100% of that passion back out as the end results. We want to make sure that we don't have, you know, we want to make sure that Invictus can decide, you know, how long the game is going to take to develop. We want to make sure that we can fully support modding, which is actually a really big thing, too. Without a publisher, we can definitely fully support modding without any kind of issues at all.
Very true.
Without a publisher involved, like with Street Legal, it was very difficult. We couldn't give anybody any kind of source code for you know, any circumstances for a very long time. And then when they finally did get it, it was very limited. So with Invictus owning 100% of the game, they are free to support the game as long as they want. They are free to allow people to mod it and help them with modding. And so it just opens up a world of possibilities and just gives us a really better end product, and as well as a cheaper game too. It won't cost as much to purchase this game as it would if a publisher was involved.
I mean that's huge. I mean, especially the time, like you said, I mean, time has killed a lot of companies from what I've seen. So I mean, you know, having your own set time is huge, and I think that is, you know, worth as much money as you can put on that value, which is
When we look at back at Street Legal Redline, and a lot of people don't know, that game was developed in 6 months.
Wow.
And that was including the game engine as well, with it, the game tech and everything, as well as the game assets and the campaign mode and everything. So when we look at that, instead of looking at it like, hey, that was a really buggy game, really I look at it like a miracle that the game even exists. So
fair
it was
enough.
Pretty amazing. They made that in 6 months, as well as patching Street Legal 1. So, you know, they had a lot of things going on. So when we look at this new game, You know, they have Invictus is comprised of about 50 employees right now, so that's much bigger, a much bigger team than it was back in the Street Legal days.
Yeah.
With more than twice the development timeline, with the game engine already being done, being Unreal Engine 4, and with the physics engine as well being done, so we're looking at a really good situation right now versus Street Legal.
Okay. Now I know you were talking about the modding, and I know that is on everybody's wish list for this game. You know, they want to start with the mods. I know a lot of games have kind of, you know, failed with that in terms of online play. You know, Spin Tires, they didn't offer any kind of mods online, so that was huge. Are you going to offer online with the mods that are allowed, or how is that going to work?
We don't really see there being any other kind of way. I mean, there's no point in modding if you can't bring those mods online. So there's many different ways to make it happen, and the specific details of that working we'll have to talk about at a later date. But I can tell you that modding and online will definitely work together. There will have to be some reasoning there, but for the most part, yes, we'll definitely work it together, and it's a top priority.
All right, so that sounds great to me. Now, in terms of the car selection and such, I'm sure you don't have a full selection yet, but will there be licensed vehicles? I know last game you used kind of the same car, like it looked identical, just with a different name. Are you going with the same plan of attack for Street Tuning Evolution?
Yes, correct. When we look at licensed cars versus non-licensed cars, in our situation, it wouldn't make sense to do licensed brands simply because the cost of doing those licensed brands is a lot of money. It's more money than it costs to develop the game. So we feel that it's better to invest that money into the development of the game directly so we can have a better product end result there versus just having some branded cars in the game. And when we look at the community with the modding that they have done for Street Legal, having licensed cars in the game right now is not a problem at all. There's thousands of cars available for download where you can throw them in Street Legal and they're licensed. So we really believe that we just want to make a really good base game here, a really nice game that's solid. And as far as the cars and stuff goes, they will be fantasy makes, but they will be great examples for people to work off of and put their licensed cars in game.
That's awesome, because I feel like a lot of companies now are scared to not do any kind of licensed vehicles. I mean, you know, games like Grand Theft Auto can get away with it. They have a huge fan base. You know, they're going to buy them. But I mean, all the other smaller developers are always scared without going.
Look at the confidence that Grand Theft Auto has when they went with fantasy cars. You know what I mean? They branded their own in-game brands and they worked that around the game. So they're very smart about how they did it. And really, there's no shame in not having licensed cars. It's just, you know, if it's not a AAA game, we don't have those kind of budgets, we just don't have it. You know, and I don't think it's going to affect the game in any kind of way. We're still going to see plenty of licensed cars in game. As soon as the game comes out, I'm very sure of it.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a big deal in terms of licensed vehicles. I just want to drive them, drift them, and do whatever.
And so, I'm sure when you have the game that you'll be downloading the, you know, mods anyway, and you'll have them anyway.
So. Exactly. Sounds great. Now, are we going to be seeing, I think this is the million-dollar question, are we going to be seeing Street Tuning Evolution released on a console anytime soon?
Sure, that's a great question. A question that, you know, that I get almost daily is about the console release. So what's important to realize is that first, the type of game that we're talking about right here, we're talking about modding support. We're talking about the kind of, when you're looking at this video here with the garage customization here, how we're clicking on parts, taking the parts off, moving around the vehicle. There will be further in-depth mechanics as well with the garage where we can tune parts, move parts around as well. So that kind of stuff, really, we need a keyboard and mouse for. It's not really going to be, it's going to be a little bit too hectic on a controller, as well as the cost to bring a game like this to the consoles is going back to what I'm talking about, licensed vehicles. It's not something that that is possible right now to do. This game just really makes sense to be on a PC, Windows and Mac. You know, same thing with the modding support. You know, modding on consoles not really appreciated. So this is really that kind of game that needs to stay on PC.
Sounds 100% good to me on that one, man. I mean, personally, I like the PC content. I mean, it's a nice, fresh, you know, you get so many more options with PC as well, too. It's just, it's incredible.
Absolutely.
Now, I know we discussed a little bit about the bugginess of Street Legal, and, you know, that was because it was, you know, on such a time crunch. I mean, like you said, it was a miracle that it even came out. In terms of Street Tuning Evolution, is there anything that's being put in place to ensure that there's no bugs, you know, this time around? Is it going to be a smooth transition? Do you want to maybe just touch base on that a little bit?
Look at back when Street Legal was made, the size of Invictus, the company was a lot smaller. The experience they had was a lot less. Since then, they've made a lot of PC games. The newer ones they've made, Level R, Project Torque, and other ones like that, they've actually still created a lot of racing games on mobile, too. So the experience of their team is far greater than it ever was. And when we're looking at, you know, we're talking about bugs and things, there is less that we have to make with this new project. Like I said, the game engine's already done. We're talking about a proven game engine. Unreal Engine 4 is extremely efficient. It's really top end stuff. You really can't beat Unreal Engine 4. So look at that game engine right there, the efficiency of that. The Invictus physics engine has been reworked over and over and re-engineered, and now it's just completely a polished product. So we bring those two things together. It's just the game, and you know, with the kind of timeline that we have here, that they've put together to ensure they have enough time for quality testing, and as well as our plans for alpha and beta releases. I really believe that when we get to the final retail product, it's going to be a very solid game by the time we get feedback from the community and just by going, you know, with the basics here of how this game is going to be put together. It's going to be a pretty good one. I don't think bugs will be of a concern. Stability will be of a concern in this game.
For sure. I mean, 100% agree with you on that. I mean, I am more than excited for this game, Dave. I cannot tell you how much I am, to be honest with you. Now, kind of moving away from, you know, the gameplay side of things and all that, I wanted to talk a little bit about the Kickstarter. There's been a lot of questions regarding the Kickstarter, stuff like that. So a lot of people are wondering, I think this is the main question, what happens if the base goal is not reached online?
That's a good question. I get that all the time. And I just want everybody to realize that if we don't make the base goal in the campaign, nobody's money will get processed. When you make a pledge on Kickstarter, the money that you pledge with is actually not taken out of your account until we reach the goal on Kickstarter and the campaign is over. So if we never reach the goal by the time the campaign's over, then your money is never moved. So it's important to realize that. So don't wait to pledge. If you wait to pledge, then all that is doing is just overall hurting the campaign as a whole. So it's really important to pledge. There's no risk in it. It's just saying, hey, I'm willing to put up this money if we make the goal. That's all it is.
Now, and also, too, just to piggyback on that, now, I did notice that, you know, if there were certain goals met, you were going to get certain things within the game, you know, considering online city maps. So if we hit the base goal, does that mean that there's not going to be any online or any, you know, city map stuff like that? How is that going to tie in?
Awesome, and that's a great question and something that I really wanted to get into more about. And if we just hit the base goal with Kickstarter and we just get the base game done, it's important to know that we will continue to accept pre-orders throughout the development of the game after the Kickstarter campaign is over.
Okay.
So we can continue to raise funds for that, as well as we can, even if we come out with the alpha version or the beta version of this game, we still plan to expand on this game and reach those stretch goals through means of game sales and such like that. So if we just reach the base goal, don't be worried. It's still our top priority to continue pushing with the game. But we have those stretch goals there just in case that we do overshoot the base goal and we go a little bit higher, then we can tell you what we can get done with that from the start. But if we can't and we can just get the base goal done, not a big deal. We will keep pushing and make sure that we can get that done.
Perfect. Now, I will leave a link to the Kickstarter in the description box below for you guys to have a look at. As he said, your money is not taken unless the goal is met. So, guys, pledge. You need to pledge in order for this game to get up there, all right? I've already done my 50. Let me know in the comments if you guys have done your 50, and we'll keep you guys with the updates. Now, going back to the PayPal and such, do we have any idea about PayPal? Now, you know, if I only have PayPal, how is that going to work on the Kickstarter?
Yeah, and that's a good question, too. With the Kickstarter, and it's really, I'm sorry to say, I'm disappointed just as much as everybody else. Kickstarter does not accept PayPal, and I just thought, you know, subconsciously that they automatically would. I mean, who doesn't? They don't accept PayPal. Instead, they deal exclusively with Amazon Payments. Now, everybody should realize that Amazon Payments and PayPal are competitors of each other. So whatever you can do with PayPal, essentially you can do it with Amazon Payments too. So if you're used to paying with your bank account through PayPal to buy stuff online, you can do the same thing with Amazon. And I know because I have both accounts. You can have your debit card, your credit cards through Amazon, whatever you have. Even if you have a PayPal balance, okay, that you want to use for this game, you can still use a PayPal debit card through Amazon to pledge for the game as well. I'm sure as many people have, you can have a debit card from PayPal.
Okay.
So there's a lot of options. You might have to be a little bit creative with it. And I know it's a huge inconvenience, and it's not something that I'm happy to have to be dealing with. It's, you know, it's one thing, you know, trying to set up a campaign and then dealing with the downfalls of the payment methods here at Kickstarter is just a whole other stress added onto that. But I just want to let everybody know that if you want to pledge, you can definitely make it happen. Just you might have to be a little creative with it.
Okay. Now, I guess I have two more questions left for you. Now, we've seen a lot of tech demos come from other game developers that are, you know, trying to do these crowdfunding style games. Are we going to be seeing any type of tech demo in the next, you know, the next couple months? Do we have any plans for that, or are we just going to be waiting till the alpha and beta to come out?
Well, the thing about the tech demo is before we started this campaign and we were talking together about this project, you know, we all agreed that a tech demo is definitely something that you want to have to see, you know, great success with the game, because it's something that people can go check out and have some hands-on experience with the game. But the issue with this is that to produce a tech demo, like you said, you know, it will take months and months of work.
Yes.
And at that point, we'll be very, very close to the alpha release, you know, as is, with the tech demo. So I'll have to talk with Invictus more about this and see if we could put out a tech demo alongside of an alpha release as well, like a free version for people to check out and try. Unfortunately, it's just not something that we can do without crowdfunding, because it's going to take too much time. And when we talk about a company like Invictus, they're too big to work on something like this for that amount of time without any upfront funding, and they're too small to afford that funding upfront. So it's a really tricky situation, and the hands are tied in a lot of places when it comes to the tech demo and crowdfunding stuff. But we realize that it's definitely a priority to provide something like that. But you know, sometimes things are a little bit tricky.
Okay, so that's pretty much, I would say, all the questions in terms of, you know, the crowdfunding, the gameplay. Now, there was one that I did miss that I actually wanted to know. I think you mentioned earlier about the Mac and PC side of things. So we are going to be doing a both cross Mac and PC compatibility on this?
Correct. Yeah, the game will be released out the box for PC, Windows, and OS X Mac.
Okay.
So and that's really cool. I think that a lot of people should take advantage of that. I know we get a lot of questions these days, you know, with new games, is it going to be released on Mac and this and that. So the good thing to know is that, yeah, we will release this for Mac. So if you are looking to use that on your computer with Mac, you can definitely do it. So we would like to spread the word about that, so people don't think that it's just for Windows. It's also for Mac.
That's awesome, which is something that's definitely new for sure. Do we have any type of, you know, price range that's going to be on this game when it's, you know, like fully out for purchase?
Sure. Well, right now, like as you know, you can pre-order it for $15 for the full retail copy.
Yep.
Now, when the final retail price comes out, I don't have an exact price on that yet, but I can tell you we can expect it to be somewhere between $25 to $30 or so.
Very, very fair. And, you know,
and that's subject to change, but I can tell you that's more or less likely than, you know, what it will be.
Awesome. Dave, I'd like to thank you very much for coming around today to, you know, chat about Street Tuning Evolution. Game looks and sounds fantastic. I am very excited. I've already pledged my 50, like I said. I'm waiting, man. I'm ready to go. I cannot wait. I'm going to be bringing you guys some SLR videos within the next couple of days to really just get hyped for this game. So I'm very excited to showcase this. I haven't really done anything in terms of that on my channel yet, so I'm very excited to do that. If you guys want to see more about Street Tuning Evolution, as I said, link will be in the description box below for you guys. Check it out. As well, too, make sure you guys subscribe. We're going to be doing updates on this game. Whenever I get them, you guys will know as well, too. Dave, thank you very much for coming around today. Is there anything else that you wanted to touch base on before we head out?
Hey, man. Well, I just want to say thank you for having me talk with you here on this video, and thanks for helping us spread the word. It really means a lot. And that's it. I think we covered a lot of stuff, and I hope everybody's excited about this new game. If they have any questions, you know, definitely feel free to ask us on the Kickstarter campaign or send us a message elsewhere, wherever they can get in touch with us.
Awesome. Now, do you think that maybe we can see you again for another update video in the next coming weeks or months?
Hey, man, anytime. You know, whatever works. I'm down for anything.
That's awesome, Dave. Thank you very much for coming around today. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you guys very much for watching today. Hope you guys enjoy the rest of your day. And I'll see you guys back here tomorrow for our regular scheduled content. Don't bring me back.